started getting really good reviews. And, you know, we ran into Jacqueline Jacks here, and she told us how to really market this stuff. And, you know, his second record came out in July of 2015. So we did two EPs last year, which led to a lot of people wanting us to play live. And that's what we've been doing, taking our time, one show a month or so. But we've been at the Bitter End in New York City, and a couple of shows at the Stone Pony, which is just amazing. They really liked our act and invited us back. So we just played there again Friday. So, you know, early exposure as kids to musical instruments. We really rocked it out in high school. And then we figured out how to play live, which got us some recognition and, you know, getting to meet some real rock stars that started coaching us as we would run into them here and there.
Yeah. That's amazing. What inspiration though, huh? I mean, once you get that taste of music and the business, it's very, very exciting. It kind of stays with you for life, you know? And I think that music brings such joy into everyone's life. You know, there's frustrating parts, I'm sure, with the business end of it being so changing and evolving. But I think that it would be sad to ever not have music in your life, you know?
Yeah, you know, we can't imagine living without it. And, you know, you just, it becomes part of you. And if you're a musician, it's different. It's not just, you know, something in the background. When you hear a song in the radio, you start hearing the bass line and the structure of the song and where is the bridge going to go? Or, you know, this is not a typical situation where you have verse, chorus, bridge, chorus. This was a little different. What did they do? So you're thinking, you're enjoying it, but you're thinking of the structure of the music. And over time, I never was into the lyrics until the last few years. You know, you would appreciate lyrics, but you wouldn't really absorb them as much. And I've learned a lot about how important the lyrics have become to not only the songwriting process, but there's a lot of people that really listen to music for the lyrics.
Yeah.
And that is really important because you're having people come to you and say, this song is kind of about this area of my life or you know, something I've been through. And you're thinking maybe it was just your experience, but there's thousands, in some cases, millions of people that can relate to those lyrics.
That's how we relate to artists. I mean, I think we take it for granted that when we get a song in our head and it replays and we're just talking the lyrics or we're singing along with the song, we've taken those lyrics in, and that's our reaction to good lyrics. So as indie music artists, we forget that people learn our songs. You know what I mean? They learn what they're about. They learn the lyrics speak to them, and that's how they communicate with the artist. It's like that's the line of communication. And I know that a lot of us are always talking about how one of our favorite things about music is the fact you get on stage, you play for a live audience, and it speaks to them, and they react, and that energy is just a wonderful exchange. But it's the lyrics in the combination with the music that actually make that all happen. That exchange and that whole scenario wouldn't happen without connected lyrics. And of course, you know, a great beat is always is always a good thing. You have a catchy beat and, you know, you're good to go. You really got it. But, you know, Joseph, you have such an unusual style and such an unusual sound that I've always taken a liking to. It's been one of my favorites that we've had on AVA Live Radio. And how did you come to that sound? Was it an evolution in the process? You know, you mentioned the several EPs. Did you have that same sound coming through as when you began, or is it something that you've come to recently? Because the song you're going to play for us tonight is actually one of my very, very favorite songs that you do. And I feel like no matter when I hear it, it's not trendy. It's more of a classic, but it's got so much energy, and it's something that I even want to start my broadcast out with it because I really enjoy it. So how did you come to that?
I was poking around a few ago and I heard the song playing. And
you can hear it. It's got that little, you know, that beginning that I just love.
So we, you know, I would say the sound is still being developed, but it was an honest sound. It was a sound that I wasn't trying to get, right? It was the melody came, the lyrics, and the chord patterns, they usually don't all come at the same time, right? You get a hook and you build a hook. And this song kind of came in one shot. It's rare that that happens. And it's kind of like singing to yourself in the shower, right? It sounds great. You're assuming nobody can hear you singing in the shower. So you're just letting loose the natural rhythm that you want to sing.
Yeah.
And this song was recorded in the middle of the night. And I remember it was like 2:30 in the morning, and my voice was all dried out. You know, I'm doing the water bottle, and I'm grooving on the song. I'm like really digging the chord. I was saying, instead of rain falling from the sky, what about sunshine? Yeah, because this is a song of positivity, you know, not missing chances in your life. And so I wanted to make that a more positive lyric. And I said, wow, that's pretty cool. This is also about New York City, right? We wrote Graveyard of Dreams was about L.A., the Sunset Boulevard. So this one's more about New York. And, what's the imagery that you see? You see taxis going by. You see homeless people, you see people doing kind acts, people doing not so kind acts, to try to capture that imagery. But at the end of the day, it was me jamming to like by myself in the middle of the night. That take captured something special, I thought. I tried to re-record it. That was the demo. And we were talking before the broadcast kicked off that we were told that Norah Jones, when she had her hit record, they used the demo for the final record to build the tracks on top of,
because
couldn't get that same sound and that same essence that she got in that moment. And I remembered that story. A friend of mine actually worked, with her on that. And yeah. I said, well, if it's good enough for Norah Jones to take a demo and build on it, I captured something there. And what I ended up doing is redoing some of the drum tracks, the foundational stuff, but everything else stayed the same on there. So the sound, I think it's still developing, but I like the idea that we're playing multiple different genres. We played an alternative country song at the Stone Pony. I announced it. I said, people either love this song or they hate it, because it's acoustic. It's got a nice country beat to it, but they don't expect us to belt out this song 16 other ways. We played it. These guys, you'll see in a minute, they put this harmony on it. And we're probably going to publish that recording tonight or tomorrow. We have to mix it down. But
that's a great idea.
That was one that we said, we're not going for a sound. Let's just play it, acoustic guitar and, harmonies live. So we're coming out in a blend of Americana rock, if that is a genre that's starting to come together. We had one song we closed the show with that we dedicated to Rob Halford of Judas Priest, right? So we're going from Americana to alternative country to heavy metal. But Craig and I met Rob, and we hung out with him for, 20 minutes at the Grammys. It was the 50th or the 52nd, we can't remember. But he 50th. And he was so nice. He was the first time he was ever in a tuxedo, and he was talking to us about the industry. And we said, we got this rock and tunes. So we're just going to not worry about genres. So I think we're developing a sound. I wrote a couple of new ones, so we'll probably launch them exclusively on your show when we're ready.
Excited! Yay!
We're kind of building that sound as we go, not worrying about genres.
Yeah, I love that. I really do. I mean, we talk a lot. You and I, especially in the last couple of weeks, have talked about the changes in the music industry, and I'm about ready to start a series of how things have actually changed and what we should be looking at for as a business model for today's indie artist. And I feel like tying yourself to one genre or tying yourself to any one thing as an artist limits your creative process. You know what I mean? And typically you want to release an EP or you want to release an album in the traditional way that tells a story, but what's saying that it actually has to be one category only? I mean, I just think that it's more authentic if you speak through the music. And I love the fact that you mix it up, because I feel like today's fan is just, they have so much exposure across the board to many different types of music in a day. It's not like they're just selecting from one round. They're not just going to iTunes. They have it in their streams on every social media. And anytime you push a button today, you can play a song and you never know what you're going to get. So it's one of those things where we have the exposure, where our minds are getting more open to different types of genres and different kinds of styles. So to limit the artist to only doing one sound or only having one thing come out of them, it really doesn't allow us to follow a journey. It just, we know what to expect already. And I like to be surprised, don't you? So it's kind of fun to see you doing that, embracing it.
And it's liberating. I mean, we were talking the other day about the idea that everybody has a full-blown video studio in their pocket now. If you have a smartphone and broadband, there's something like 2.4 billion mobile phones with broadband connections. Billion, right? In the last few years, it went from, you know, a few hundred million to billions in terms of internet connectivity just in the last 7 or 8 years. So the fact that we can now experiment with genres at a very low cost and put that up on Reverb Nation, and we don't mind if it's one fan or 10,000 fans. If there's one other person who dug that song that we decided, let's just throw it out there because we like it and see if somebody else likes it. You're going to find people all over the world, and we're on some services where we have, you know, fans in 40 different countries and things that we never imagined people would be interested in. It's really a low cost, and you learn, right, by experimenting. And I think you become a better musician by borrowing from different genres and mixing it up. And that's how new things were created, dubstep and, you know, all you know, different kinds of experimentation going on today in music happen because people are curious and they have access to try new things.
They are. I would think that your music fans, too, would embrace the changes. I think that they've got to be excited about, for instance, this new song you're about ready to drop. I mean, you produced it relatively easily, and you know, you're getting it out to the fans without them having to wait too long for new material. Do you find that that works for you? That's a great way to keep the excitement going and keep people in the mix with you from day to day?
Yeah, and you talked to us, several times about the importance of merchandising and the things, you know, not for the money, but for the fan base, the things that we take for granted. We have set lists in the back here. We signed set lists, and we gave them away to the fans, signed posters, and we ran out. I mean, people couldn't believe, on this big, we came down and we started handing out, you know, signed posters. I think Rich has got a couple back there. And what we learned is when we record a live performance, here's our Stone Pony banner.
I love it. That's great.
This is your idea, John. Like, you know, sign.
I'm so glad. Thank you so much. That's awesome.
On that. And we also learned that when you do a live performance and it goes well and there's a lot of energy in the room, you know, we're excited as musicians just to listen back to all the mistakes. And we were joking earlier, you know, our mutual dysfunction aren't in real time. Earlier tonight, like, oh my goodness, we sped up, we slowed down, we put a sample on a heavy metal song on Mama Don't Call Me Home. So go to reverbnation.com/Joseph Pagano, you can download it free. And nobody's ever saxo on a heavy metal song. So there's a demand for when you do something new or a show goes well, people want that recording right away. So we published that first song last night, and it's a matter of us just getting time to, you know, to chop it up and you know, put it through Pro Tools or whatever. So we're going to more of that, right? We're going to think about those little things that people like, the outtakes or the acoustic version of something, right?
So glad. Yeah, I'm so excited about that. I really am, because even me as your music fan, that's something I'm like craving to see. I can't wait to see it. You know, it gives me something to look forward to, a reason to come back to your social pages, a reason to look you up in like everything that might be going on in a day. It makes it memorable. And I can even imagine if somebody was at a concert and you handed them something signed, like a set list or like, you know, whatever it is that you brought for your audience, for your live audience, it's like a calling card that makes a huge impression on them because you took the time to get off the stage and you actually, you know, said, hey, I want you to have this, you know, and that just will translate throughout their day. It'll bring them back to the internet, which is where they buy music if they don't buy right there at that venue. You know?
Yep.
So I love that. I love anything you can get to get people's attention and bring them out of themselves and say, you're here in this moment and I want you to be here with us. But I not only want this time, but I want your time when you get back to your computer too. I want you to come and see what we've got going on tonight or tomorrow, you know?
Crave that feedback loop, and it's an excuse to talk to people, not just, hey, you guys did great, and the excitement of meeting. People give us feedback, and they almost unanimously said that the story, so we decided that we're going to tell a story before every song, except for when, you know, we're towards the end of the season, repeating songs together, ready to kick us off. But we get these strict time limits, and we push it at the end, so we change songs together. But that's just true. About, you know, maybe out of a 10-song set, we'll tell 7 stories, one Love before it. Each. And people enjoy the stories as much as the song, in some cases more. Mm-hmm. Like the story made the song. Had no idea how you recorded it or what you were thinking or what it was about.
I know. And nobody does it. It's amazing.
Nobody does it is right. And they said, hey, the other bands just come up and they play. And, you know, they're very good, but they play. And the idea that you, you know, put the story behind it, as minimal as it, you know, you think it is, it puts context around it. And it allows people to appreciate it more and listen more deeply. And I never thought that. I was just kind of filling time and, you know, trying to get my guitar tuned up.
Yeah, no, it makes that personal connection. And it really does draw people in. Because otherwise, if you notice, typically when you play at venues, people are just into themselves and talking, but that if you can engage them in some way in the stories or even entertain that person that's there by themselves and really, like, you know, get that chance to have that connection with them in a more authentic way, then it's not just you being removed because you're just up on the stage and they're down there drinking with their friends. It's more like you're involving the audience as much as you can. And I think that's, it makes you an entertainer. It makes you, like, have the ability to command a room and not just be in the room. And I think that makes wonderful
too. You know, we're at the bar at the Stone Pony and a couple of the guys said, you had control. And we're not trying to get control. We're just trying to connect with the audience. But yeah, they said when a couple of these stories that you told, people were leaning in and you had control over everybody's attention in the room, and they're asking, when are you going to play next? And can you play further north so we don't drive all the way to the beach? And,
that just tells you they now you made a connection. Yeah. You see, they feel like comfortable to come up. They know you now. They can call, you know, talk to you and ask you for questions for where you should play and stuff like that. Huge, huge. That's big time. That's what makes a band go from just a cover band or a band that's just playing to a band that everybody wants to be watching and following and engaging with and being part of the journey. And you are capturing that and you're really making that happen. And I'm so excited to be able to feature it and tell people about you, because I think that you're doing everything just so right.
Well, we have a great coach and teacher. So thanks for your advice. We actually listen and we try to do in steps and not try to do everything at the same time. But, you know, like you said the other day in the marketing panel, the key is just get started, right? Pick some area and just start doing it. And I joked that Bruce Springsteen, we live by this. He was doing an interview very early in his career. He's a few years in and he's going on stage and somebody stuck a microphone in his face and said, Bruce, what's the key to success? And he stops. He stops going on stage. He comes back down the stairs and he goes, that's a great question. He goes, but here's the key to my success. He goes, if you get their asses moving, their souls will follow.
Up on the stage, I'm like, I love it. That's great.
I've used that in business. We use it in the band. And the comment you made earlier about the beat is really important. Right? There's other things that are important, but getting the beat going and the groove going gets them moving enough to start listening to the lyrics and learn more about the band and so on. So, you know, we like to learn everything.
Yeah, I noticed that when you're listening to great lyrics and you have a great band, you have a great groove and everything is working in combination, once that beat kind of takes over and you really get into it, you draw the audience to you and then they start listening and learning the lyrics. It's almost as if the beat and the melody starts to open our minds and be able to take it in. And when you have a song that's like contrasting and working against itself, where like the beat's not there, but the lyrics are great, but they're not quite hooking properly, it really just kind of falls apart. And that's a shame, because there's so many wonderful songs out there that have such great lyrics and so much to say, but because they're missing that backbone, you know, it doesn't quite grab our attention as fans, as music fans or listeners, as it should. So that just shows you how all of the players really need to come together, and they all have to really work their parts to make it all happen. And you guys make it look easy, but it's really, there's a science to it. There's a method to it. It's a lot of great talent coming together to make it all work like that. And yeah, that's one of the things that, you know, it's like I said, you make it seem so effortless, but we know what it takes to actually get it to happen.
Well, I have a guy that is probably the best lyric instructor in the world. His name is Pat Pattison. He teaches and runs I think the songwriting department at Berklee School of Music, and he puts on a free songwriting course on Coursera. So anybody out there can go find it, and it goes like 4 times a year, and they let you download all the videos. And he was John Mayer's teacher. In fact, John Mayer went to mentor some of the students of Pat and discussed the impact that Pat had on his songwriting. So I have to say that, you know, we learn from some of the great people out there, and this is accessible for free. You can go learn from a guy like Pat Pattison, and maybe you buy a book or two of his. But he, in combination with these other influences, really put some structure, you know, around the process, right? Learning the craft, honing in on your craft, perfecting it. And although he says, you know, there are no rules to it, you or these techniques, and you borrow, and you decide what you want to use and not use. But I think developing your craft is something that anyone who's serious as an independent artist will want to study a little bit up on, because it just uplifts your ability to deliver the art, to make decisions on the balance of art and science. And when you start taking the advice of these people, the connection with the fans and the lyrics, like we were talking about earlier, you know, people email and, oh my goodness, I just heard the song Chances. That's unbelievable. You know, and people driving their trucks, blasting your stuff, things you would never, you know, think you'd get feedback on.
That's incredible. Incredible. Well, thank you so much for sharing that story with us. And it's great to have you here. I love that you're part of my live streaming team and will be involved in the future music industry panels that I will be dragging you into every so often. I like to surprise you guys. So are you ready to get us up out of our chairs and get some music going? Because we're dying to see.
We're going to do Don't Let Chances Pass You By. And the biggest thing we've got to figure out right now is we've got this little square camera here to fit the whole band in. So
can you back the camera away maybe a little bit? Do you want to try that?
Do that. Yeah, angle it a little bit.
Back the camera off as much as you can. I know it's got to be, I mean, you have only so much room in the room, but
see how messy the studio area is right here. And let me go up a little bit there.
There we go. Right. Hey there. I can see you guys now. Hey. That's awesome.
Your guitar set up there.
Yeah. So I'm going to grab my guitar. We actually have a recorder here.
So Rich, you can come right in. Come right here.
Yep. Yeah, I'm going to grab the pick here.
Too hard. Don't forget the story. I want to hear this story.
Oh, look at this. I think the band is in the shot. Look
at
this.
Wow. Hey, Joe, you got that thing running?
I love it.
I got to tee this up. Right. So this song is about the idea that, you know, we have so many interactions in our daily lives, and there's so many positive things that happen, and we often miss chances in those interactions to treat each other better, make the world a better place. It also has some overtones and undertones of life in New York City and you know, the imagery of New York City. So that's a little bit about the song that we're going to play. It's called Don't Let Chances Pass You By. You can download this song from a couple of different internet sites or pick it up on the Graveyard of Dreams album. All right, can you hear okay?
Yeah, I can hear great. Great sound. Right. Are you just using the regular audio?
Yeah, we're going through the regular audio on a MacBook Pro. We've got Periscope on an iPad here. And we've got an H6 recorder just to capture the performance You can hear everything okay there?
Yeah, I can hear great. I'm excited. I don't even need it. We've got the audio on AVA Live Radio right now, and I think it's going to sound perfect, so I'm not going to do anything. I'm just leaving it alone. Go ahead.
So here, I want to introduce the band. On my left here is Gary Keys Evans. He's got on the bass there. We got a little bass amp set up, and I told the story about Gary. He grew up in Montclair, New Jersey. He was neighbors with Joe Walsh from the Eagles.
Wow, I love the Eagles.
And I don't think Gary realized he was neighbors with Joe Walsh. Well, a few years ago, not at the house, and you know, they hand Gary the phone and they say, Joe's on the phone. So Gary's like, Joe, he gets on the phone. Joe Pagano? The guy's like, no, it's Joe.
That's great.
So Gary talked to him for a while. I told this story at the Stone Pony. We were a little rushed in the time we had towards the end of the set.
Abbreviated version.
So this is Rich Giacomelli behind me.
Hello there.
Playing with Rich, he put together a famous horn section called the Hub City Horns out of New Brunswick, New Jersey. We used to play the Blues Brothers sets and Huey Lewis and all sorts of different things. And I just signed up Rich a few days ago, right? Yes. I called him out of the blue, and I'm like, you know, Rich, we got to play. And he said, fine. And now he's doing sax solos and heavy metal songs. And
just background vocals.
Craig Bleifer, known Craig since high school. And you know, Craig is really helping new life into these songs. So we play them different every single time we perform them live. I think it's exciting for people because it's a different interpretation of what you hear on the record. And we generally try different things every time we play a song. And it's fabulous. Exciting for us. The problem is sometimes we forget what chords we're supposed to be doing. And,
that's great.
I call it art, right? What is art without mistakes, you know, worked
that's
into it, right?
Exactly true, yes. You should never be afraid to try something different just because you're fearing that it might not turn out right, because that's never really art. And I think that even your Periscope fans, if they see these different versions come out or live streaming on YouTube or live streaming on Facebook, whichever you decide to do, I think that they'll really enjoy it. And it'll give people a reason to come back and just see what you're up to, you know, because you're doing things differently.
Yep, absolutely. So thanks for the ideas and the coaching, and keep it coming.
Always. All right, here we go. Joseph Pagano Band. What are we playing? My favorite song, I think, right?
Yeah, don't let chances pass you by.
Yay.
I look at the world between the headlines, and that's where I find truth. Teaching a child to save an insect, and that's when I met you. American girl star in the city, where billions of dreams come true. A beggar was asking for a dollar, and Hugo gave him two. If all of the world could be so giving, maybe we'd all find truth. Sunshine's pouring from the sky. Yellow taxi passing by. What do you say? Let's go for a ride. Don't let chances pass you by. How do you make it in the city? A pretty girl like you, where everyone judges by the cover. Now what's inside of you? If all of the world
let's go for a ride. For a chance to pass you by. Homeless man, be smiling wide. There's dusty dreams and bloodshot eyes. Stay in the main, the grown man cry. Don't let chances pass you by. Such a pouring from the sky. Yellow tags pass you by. What do you say? Let's go for a ride. Don't let chance pass you by. Don't let chance pass you by. Don't let chance pass you by.
Great job. Great job. Thank you guys so much for being here. I am so excited that you did this streaming event with us, and I cannot wait until everybody gets to see it on the replays and all that we have going on moving forward. Thank you guys for being here. I appreciate you. I really do. You did a great job, and it's so cool to see you here on Blab, like right in my office.
We love everything you're doing, Jacqueline. Keep it going. Thanks for everything.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. So don't forget, we can find Joseph Pagano Band at josephpagano.band, correct?
Yep, and on ReverbNation/Joseph Pagano.
Awesome. And if you want to get the links for his band and all the music that we've been talking about on the show tonight, just go to avaliveradio.com, look for Joseph Pagano on there, and we have a full list of his links for you. So everything from YouTube to Google+, Tumblr, all of the pages are available for you guys. I don't want you to miss one single thing of what he's got going on, because as you can tell just by this conversation, he has so many surprises for you. And I, for one, cannot wait to see them. So definitely, I mean, I don't want to miss one single second of it. So don't let me miss anything.
You won't. You won't at all. Well, thank you so much, and we'll be in touch for sure.
I'll see you guys soon. Have a great night.
Thanks, everyone, for listening. Take care.
Cool deal. Cool deal. That was Joseph Pagano on AVA Live Radio, guys, for live streaming 2016. I hope you enjoyed it, and I certainly hope to see you joining us every Tuesday, as we have something really cool in store for you, and you never know what it is. That's what live streaming is all about. So thanks for being here, and I will catch you again very, very soon. Have a great day.